appreciate you.
Good morning. How's everyone today? I thought wintertime was over. Wintertime is not over, is it? Let's all stand together. We're going to sing, and as you're standing, turn to somebody this morning and tell them, good morning, glad to see you, all right? One, two, three, four. Stay on the G, boys. Put together before, but we're going to right this moment. I come to the garden of I knew you'd know that.
While the dew is still on the roses and the
church, ready?
And he walks with me, and he talks with me, and he tells me I am his own, and the joy we share as we tarry in
Father, a hand, and you may be seated as Brother Charles comes up. Thank you.
Amen. Thank you, Michael. What a special day every Sunday is. We celebrate the resurrection of our blessed Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, and we want to welcome you here today. If you are a guest, you're an answered prayer. We pray fervently every week that God would send guests our way to join us in our celebration of the resurrection of Christ. And you're here today. You are a blessing to us, and we want to be a blessing to you. After service, Mike and Kim will be out the doors just to my right. They have a gift for you, and they'd like for you to come by. There's a guest card somewhere near you in the pew. If you would just give us some information about yourself so we can be in contact with you and you with us, and let you know what maybe the Lord is doing here and how that you may want to be a part of that. So that's after service. We appreciate you doing that. And thank you for taking some time to fill out that little card and get it to Mike and Kim. We have a special guest today. Fernando and his family is coming. Brother Fernando, would you come up on the platform? We have a microphone for you. Right here, yeah, grab that.
Okay.
Brother Fernando is a pastor in Mexico, has a heart for the Lord, an evangelistic heart. They're not only just pastoring, but he's planting churches. And we're so excited about being a part of that ministry with him and being able to, in some way, make a contribution. His family is with him. He can introduce your family.
Yes, sir.
And then just tell us a little bit about what God is doing.
Thank you, sir.
All right. God bless you.
Thank you. God bless you all. I'm sorry for my English. I speak a little English. But it's a wonderful for my family. It's amazing for my family visit this church. We're feeling your love for God and for the mission camp, mission field. My family, we are Ramon's family. My wife, Carolina. My big son, Fernando Jr. And my little son, Otoniel. Otto. And she girl is Alexa. We are Ramon's family, serve of God. In 1 hour to Monterrey in Mexico. Probably you listen the name in Monterrey. We served for 15 years ago in Cadereyta City, 1 hour to north to Monterrey. And we have another church in the mountains, 4 hours and a half to Monterrey. So thank you for your love for my family, for the ministry. Brother Harry is really blessed for my family, the class. Brother Harry,
amen.
And Brother Jeff and Sister Dell and Sister G visit. We filled mission camp in Monterrey the last year. And Pastor, thank you for permit this little group visit my country. And I need to say only one thing. Thank you, American Christian, American people, for gospel, for send the gospel many years ago to Mexico.
Amen.
Thank you.
Hallelujah.
Now Mexican Christians want continue with your work for me, for my country. Now Mexico wanted send the gospel, not only the country in Mexico, but another countries. So thank you, American people, for love my country.
Amen.
God bless
amen.
You.
Amen. Amen.
Thank you.
Thank you. So, you know, right now we have a Hispanic service that goes on simultaneously with this service and a children's service that goes on simultaneously with this. Brother Harry, I think, is going to take Pastor Fernando and his family down to our Hispanic service. And isn't it great that we have that going on right here in our church every week? Amen. And we love you all. We love you all. What a blessing to get to have them. It's a rare opportunity for them to be able to spend on a Sunday time here with us, and we appreciate it so much. Now, we talked about them being on mission in Mexico, and our church being able to, in some ways, assist them in some things. And it's been miraculous how they needed a truck that would, four-wheel drive, that would go up in the mountains. And we were praying about it, and we needed money for this truck. And I got a call, a person that doesn't even come here, and said, I have some money. I want to invest in the ministry. It was exactly what we needed.
Amen.
Amen. And it's just been one story like that again and again, because there's power in prayer. And I hope that inspires you to be on mission here. Easter Sunday, more people are willing to go to church on Easter Sunday than any other Sunday in the entire year. The two greatest attended services, as a matter of fact, in this country over the last decade has been Christmas Eve service and Easter Sunday service. Brother Mike and Kim have printed up and provided us invitations to give out to people about coming here on Easter Sunday. They're all across the front down here. If you would get some of these and start inviting unchurched people who normally don't go to church to come with you on Easter Sunday. Listen, don't say no for people. Don't say no. We think, oh, they wouldn't want to come. Well, how do you know they wouldn't want to come? In survey after survey done, over 95% of the people were asked, what would it take for you to visit a church or a synagogue in the area where you live? They would say, 95%, listen, an invitation from someone who goes there. Simple as that. We can be people of invitation. I'm going to ask you if you would help us and pray for us that, wouldn't it be great on Easter Sunday if we had to have chairs out in the foyer? Wouldn't that be awesome? Praise the Lord. It'd be an awesome thing. And we want to invite you to help us invite our community literally to come. I believe you're going to take this challenge and be involved in this.
And also, Brother Charlie, with the invite cards, we also have yard signs.
Oh, yeah, I forgot that.
For your yard out in the foyer. Grab one of those for your house and stick it out there in your yard.
Yeah. Of course, the best form of advertisement is a satisfied customer. So go out there and be that voice, all right? We're so glad that you're here today. We thank God for you. Let's pray together. Father, we thank you for Fernando and his family. I thank you for the small role that Central Baptist has had in their ministry there. A man of God with a heart for you, who just loves to tell the good news that Jesus Christ is who he said he was and did what he said he would do. I pray, Father, the Hispanic service is going on, our children's service going on, our worship service going on in here together, that, Lord, you would bless us by anointing our service. I pray, Lord, that this would truly be a sanctuary unto you today, that through our praises to you, our prayers unto you, Lord, our preaching about you, God, today, that you would be exalted and glorified. Lord Jesus, we give this service to you. We ask you, Lord, to make an impact in our life. Speak to us today, I pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Let's stand together, please.
Jesus came forth to be born of a virgin, dwelt among men, my example is he. One day they led him of Calvary's mountain, one day they nailed him to die on a tree. Suffering, anguish, despised and rejected, bearing our sins, my Redeemer is here.
bring light to the darkness. You give hope. You restore every heart that is broken. And great are you, Lord. You give life. You give life.
Is there anybody in this room today that has a broken heart? Come on, be honest before God in your church tonight, this morning. Anybody ever had a broken heart in your life? Let's say that. Does God restore that? Does it sometimes take time? Yeah? Could we give testimonies about how long it took some of us to get a restored heart? Yeah? Don't give up hope today if you're here and you have a broken heart. It can be fixed. He's the great physician, isn't he? Sometimes we sing these words and we just let them go right over our heads. We need to stop sometimes and think about these. You give hope, you restore every heart that is broken. Then we sing this. Great are you, Lord. It's your breath.
Oh, come out of sadness from wherever you've been. Come brokenhearted, let rescue begin. Come find your mercy, oh sinner, come near. 'Cause earth has no sorrow that heaven can't heal. Earth has no sorrow heaven can't heal.
Thank you, choir. You can excuse yourself. Praise team, you can, and y'all can have a seat. Unless you want to stand, you're welcome to stand. We can have Christian aerobics right here.
Voices in my mind that say I'm not enough. Every single lie that tells me I will never measure up. the sum of every high and every low. Remind me once again just who I am, because I need to know.
Thank you, Hannah. What a beautiful reminder to us that we are enough in God. And that's really what I want to talk about today from the Word of God, God's vision for His church, honoring our past and preparing for our future. We're in a series of messages that leads up to the last Sunday in the month of April, at a capital campaign where we're hoping that all of us will see the vision and be willing to give toward and sacrifice with what God has enabled us to make a difference for all the people that's coming. We know that people are coming. There's not anything we can do. They'll guarantee that our church will receive them, but there's a lot of things we can do. They'll guarantee that we won't. And we don't want to be the latter, right? We want to be the first. We're going to do the possible and ask God to do the impossible. And when I was praying about this series of messages leading up to his April 30th and our commitment day of our capital campaign, obviously, you know, if I were you, I would be thinking, well, I'm going to have six messages on giving. But really, that is not what God wants, and that's not what the capital campaign should be about. The capital campaign should be about what we should be about, and that's becoming more like Christ. One of the greatest books in the Bible is the book of Colossians. If you want to open to the book of Colossians as pertaining to the preeminence of Christ. They're all the books in the Bible are great. I can't say one better than the other, obviously. But this book is talking about the preeminence of Christ, that Christ needs to be preeminent in our life. In chapter 1, Paul begins talking about that. Look at verse 9, if you will, of Colossians chapter 1. He said, "For this reason we also, since the day that we heard of it, do not cease to pray for you and ask." And here's the prayer. I've learned to pray scripture over people and over situations and over trials, because I'm not always sure that I know the will of God, but I'm always sure that God's Word knows the will of God. And so I often pray this prayer for myself and for other people, the prayer that Paul prayed, that we may be filled with the knowledge of His will in all wisdom and spiritual understanding. Do you need to know the will of God in your life? We all do. We're praying about, God, what do you want me to do in this capital campaign? How is that going to affect my life? Give me wisdom, spiritual understanding. Verse 10, that you might walk worthy of the Lord, fully pleasing Him, being fruitful in every good work and increasing in the knowledge of God, strengthened with all might according to His glorious power, for all patience and long-suffering with joy, giving thanks to the Father who has qualified us to be partakers of the inheritance of the saints in the light. Verse 13, He has delivered us from the power of darkness and conveyed us into the kingdom of the Son of His love, in whom we have redemption through His blood, the forgiveness of sin. He is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn over all creation. For by Him all things were created that are in heaven and that are on earth, visible and invisible, whether thrones or dominions or principalities or powers. All things were created through Him, and listen to this, for Him. Will you pray with me again? Father, as we come to this passage, Lord, and we talk about everything that You have created has its purpose today. I pray, Lord, that You would anoint this time, that You would quicken our minds, make it alive. Lord, let us receive Your message to our own heart today, and give us both the power and the will to say yes, a full yes, to everything that You're saying to us in our own heart, in our own life. In Christ's name we pray, amen. God never created anything without a purpose. Did you notice the Bible says that all things were created? He's talking about Christ. For Him, through Him, and for Him. Every plant has a purpose. Every animal has a purpose. Every planet and star in the universe, every person has a purpose. Every one of us. If anyone wants to know the purpose of their life, they have to start with God. If anyone wants to know the purpose of a church, they have to start with God, because God created everything. Amen? And if He created everything, then He has a purpose for everything that has been created. The truth is, if I were to have some invention, now that'd be a joke in and of itself if I invented something, but let's just say I invented something and I had it here and you'd never seen it before, and you go, what does it do and what is it about? This whole invention, there's only two ways that you would understand what that invention is about. Either A, talk to the one who created it, or B, read the owner's manual that came with it. And when we think about our life, there's only two ways that we're going to know the purpose of our life, and that is A, talk to the Creator who made us, amen, and number two, read the owner's manual that talks about it. And God has a purpose for us. That's the only way that we're ever going to know our purpose. And so if you want to know the purpose of your life, if you want to know the purpose of this church, then we have to talk with the Creator who created us, and we have to read the Word of God. Now, today is week two in our capital campaign, focusing on a vision reaching all the people that are coming into this area. They're moving here literally by the thousands. Coffin County, the fastest growing county, not in Texas, but in the United States of America. Fastest growing. That is amazing that is going on. And I want to talk about God's vision for all of us and why I believe that we need to prepare, including sacrificing for this once-in-a-lifetime opportunity. I was reading this week Eugene Patterson, the Message paraphrased edition of the Word of God in Ephesians chapter 1. I was reading Ephesians out of that. I don't always do that, but I sometimes do. And Ephesians chapter 1, verse 11, I thought it's interesting. Eugene Patterson reads like this: "It is Christ that we find out who we are and what we are living for. Part of the overall purpose of His working out everything and everyone." I appreciated the way he stated that. It is in Christ that we find out what we are to be living for. In Colossians chapter 1, verse 16, out of the Living Bible, it says, "Everything, absolutely everything, got its start and finds its purpose in Him." So let me summarize it. We are made by God, and we are made for God. I want to say that again. We are made by God, and we are made for Him. And until we understand this, really, your life, my life, is really not going to make any sense if we don't understand that. We are the crowning of God's creation. We are immortal. And there's a difference. God is eternal. God has neither beginning or end. Animals are mortal. They have a beginning at conception and a conclusion at death. But the Bible talks about mankind as being immortal. We had a life beginning at creation, and we will live throughout eternity. One day, my heart is going to stop beating. And I like what Billy Graham said before he died. There's going to be somebody one of these days is going to tell you, "I died." Don't believe it. One of these days, my heart is going to stop beating, and this body will be done with, but not the end of me. Not the end of me. I have a body. I am a soul. Now, I keep talking about this all the time. I'm hoping God's taking my hint. In my glorified body, God, 6 foot at least. I'm going to get a new body. It's a glorified body that's coming. Amen. But I am going on into eternity. And so it means that I'm going to spend more time on the other side of this life than I did on this side. If you live 70, 80, 90, even 100 years, we would consider 100 years old to be a long time of living in this earth, in our modern day world in which we live. But my friend, that is nothing compared to the trillions of years that we are going to live in our afterlife. And so we need to be understanding that this is not all there is to it. And God has a purpose for me. And the purpose, one of the purposes of my life right now is to prepare for eternity. So if somebody asks you, what is the purpose of life? Say this: my purpose in life is to get ready for my afterlife. I mean, like, this is kindergarten, getting ready for the real deal. This is a dress rehearsal, if you will, getting ready for the day that is to come. How exciting that is that we know that that's going to come. We're getting ready for eternity. In eternity, we're going to be active, involved in many ways. The Bible doesn't tell us everything there is to know about eternity. As a matter of fact, it's vague. We know a lot. We know enough to say it's going to be a cool deal, right? But the Bible doesn't tell us everything. You know why? Because we wouldn't get it. It's in a whole other dimension of life. We would never be able to understand everything there is about it. But I'm telling you, God said, "I have a place prepared for you." And listen, the Bible says we're going to rule and reign with Christ. I don't even know what all that means. I keep thinking, look, I might be the president of Jupiter. I mean, I don't know. But I'm going to rule and reign with Christ. I know that. What I do know about eternity is that we are to be involved now on what we will be doing then, and that is in some way ruling and reigning with Christ throughout the universe. We will not be angels. The idea of floating on a cloud playing a harp just is a turnoff to me. I don't know about you. We're not going to be angels. We are who we are, living souls. We're going to get a new body. It's going to be an eternal body. It's a body designed for eternity. And we're going to be fulfilling the purpose of God. Now, what does that have to do with a capital campaign? And what does that have to do about Central Baptist Church right now? Because if we're going to prepare for the future, we got to prepare who we are now to do what God wants us to do through eternity. Does that make sense to you? That's the premise of the message this morning that I want to talk about. And there's three or four points that I want to just make note of. Number one, God's purpose is to live in intimate relationship with our Heavenly Father. It is God's purpose for you and I to live in intimate relationship with our Heavenly Father. Our church is not a building. Our church is people. And that's what we should be about. Buildings are a necessary thing that we have in this life so that we can gather together and worship together and praise the Lord together and be involved in that to give the gospel of Jesus Christ in a more effective way. We are, as God's children, we are planned for His pleasure. Listen to the Revelation chapter 4. Listen to this. You, God, created everything, and it is for your pleasure that they exist and that they were created. In Psalms, the psalmist said in 149 verse 4, the Lord takes pleasure in His people. Now I get that. The Lord takes pleasure. I read that and I was thinking about taking pleasure in your kids. Almost all parents love watching their kids most of the time. Not all the time, but most of the time. And I remember when the twins were born, and we brought them home from the hospital. They were at our house with their mom, Robin, and we were making a home. And I remember we were on shifts. And we'd have to mark the bottle, you know. Okay, this was Kaylee, and this was Caden, because Kaylee would eat all of them. She's not here, so I can pick on her. But, you know, I would hold one of those babies, and I just loved holding them and watching them. It's just something, it's something precious. And here's the point. God, do you know God loves you in that way, but more than you could ever imagine. More than you could ever imagine. Some people think that the only reason that they are born in this world is for the Heavenly Father to have someone to spank or to aggravate. They think the only time God is pleased with them is when they're at church or doing some religious activity. But can I share something with you today? That God just loves you because you're you. God just loves you because you're you. We are a product of God's love, created by God to be loved by God, and that we might reciprocate that love back to God. God loves you simply because you're you. Let's look at Ephesians chapter 1, verse 4 again. Eugene Patterson concludes in this, as he writes this, he says, long before He laid the earth's foundation, God had us in mind and settled on us as the focus of His love. Now, I think that's important to say this, that God is love. He doesn't just have love. I want to say that again. God is love. He doesn't just have love. Love is the very essence of His character and of His nature. We exist because we are an object of God's love. Now, love is only love when it's manifested in something. You can say, well, I love this, I love that, but you have to demonstrate that love toward it. And we know that God demonstrated his love for us in that he was willing to die in our place so that we could become the righteousness of God, so that we could be changed, our lives could be different. He made that possible because of his great love for us. It's not that God needs us because he is lonely. How many of you know God is not lonely? He is love, and that's the essence of his nature. And that, my friend, is the antidote to our insecurities in our life and our low self-esteem. I need to hear that. That God loves me because he's me, because I'm me. I mean, that's just hard for me to believe that God does it. But God does. He loves me simply because I am his creation. He made me. We need to have a capacity to know and love God. That's what makes us different from the animal world. You'll never see a kitty fold its hands and say grace before it eats. Why? Well, they're not created in the image and likeness of God. There's a difference. God has created us with a capacity to know God, to love God, and to be loved by God. You know, one day Jesus was going with the disciples, and a young man came before the Lord, and he said, which is the greatest commandment in all the world, in all of the Bible? He had the Old Testament. Which is the greatest of all the commandments? And you know, there were many commandments in the Old Testament. And here's what Jesus said. It is to love the Lord your God with all of your heart, with all of your soul, with all of your mind, and with all of your strength. This is the first and greatest commandment. In Hosea, the Old Testament, the prophet said this to the people of Israel. God says, I don't want your sacrifices. I want your love. I don't want your offerings. I want you to know me. Do you know, more important than anything else, God wants from you and God wants from me is that we love him because he's God. We love him because he's God. Because of what he has done in our life and what that means to us, because he is our Heavenly Father. Do you sense the passion of God when you read those passages? I do. God is passionately in love with us. The most important thing that we can know in this life is that God loves us and that we matter to God. And the most important thing that you can do in this life is to know him more and love him better. In my own devotional time, I try to begin every day by saying something like this to God, I love you. Help me to love you more today and know you better. I don't care what I do in the day. Everything might fall apart, go south. Nothing's ever easy. You know what I'm talking about. You have those days in your life. But at the end of the day, I can sit down and say, I know God better and love him more than it was a successful day. I don't care how successful your day might seem to have been. Closed a deal, made a sale, got an accomplishment, some task that was laying before you. But at the end of the day, you don't know God better and you do not love God more, then that day's not been a successful day for you. Because everything about our life is to help us love God more and know him better. Now, here's the tragedy. The tragedy is that most people go through their entire life missing the main purpose of their life. They know so many things. I am so impressed with the knowledge of some people that they have. They just know things. And we know so many things. There are so many people that are so intelligent in this world. And I'm always amazed by that because I'm not one of them. So I guess I look up to people that I feel like that are. But let me tell you something. While we know so much, if they don't know God, they've missed the point of life. You say, well, why would you say that? Because the Bible says that. Listen to what the Bible says in 1 Timothy chapter 6, verse 21. Some people have missed the most important thing in life. They don't know God. Some people have missed the most important thing in life. They don't know God. Nothing can fill the God-sized hole in your heart but God himself. Now, people are trying to fill that void in their life all the time with all sorts of things. And you name it. I could just pick hundreds of things that I could begin to mention and talk about, that this is what we're trying to fill, that emptiness, that void in your heart. But I want to tell you something. Prestige and power and pleasure, none of those things can fill the void. Successes, sexual experiences, nothing in your life is ever going to fill the void of your life, because God created a vacuum in your heart that only can be filled by His presence only. Only God can do that. So what does this have to do with the capital campaign? There are literally thousands of people moving here, and a majority of those people have missed the very point of life. And who is going to tell them the good news? Listen, what I'm talking about today is good news. Amen? News that is life-changing and altering in their life. So we were born to meet and to know and to love God, not to know about God. And listen, there are thousands of people that know about God. I'm not talking about that. I'm talking about knowing God. And we have an opportunity to tell the world there is a Savior, and His name is Jesus Christ. He is who He said He was. He did what He said that He would do. We back down from nothing and no one. That there is only one way to heaven, and that's through Jesus Christ. And the only way you're ever going to know God or find the purpose for your life is to know that Jesus Christ is the Messiah. Yes. To be part of God's family is the second thing. To have a church. Everyone is a creation of God, but not everybody is part of the family of God. God formed us to be a family. Now, the Bible says that God wants us to be a family. You know, the church was God's idea. Well, it wasn't the people's idea. It was God's idea. The ecclesia, the called out ones, called unto Himself to be in fellowship with Him and to be in relationship with Him. The church is not an organization. The church is not a denomination. The church is people who are in relationship with Jesus Christ as Lord of their life. That's what the church is. And so God has called everybody out to be a part of His church. And there's only one way to be a part of the church, and that is to be born into it. Everybody in the world is a creation of God, but not everybody's a child of God. And so how do you become a child of God? Well, in our world, there's two ways to become a member of a family. A, be born into that family, or number two, be adopted in that family. Would you agree with that? And did you know the Bible says that God does both of those things to us when we come to Him in faith? We are born and adopted. Now, that's a little confusing, I think, to some people. What is the adoption of God, and what is the being born again into God? Let me explain that. The references of Paul in the New Testament, for instance, we talked about last week the armor of God. Where was Paul? He was in a Roman prison, standing the Praetorian Guard around him, dressed in the army. He thought, that's a good illustration, the Holy Spirit. That's a good illustration to help people understand the armor of God, what it means to be covered in the armor of God. And so the world had an influence, if you will, about illustrating what he's talking about. And so in the Greek world, a child was born, a Roman world, born into the family, and they were born into that family. They were a member of that family. But you know, they were schooled by schoolmasters, most of them. Most of the children in the Roman Empire, parents didn't have a lot of parental action like we think about today. It was different. And when they reached a certain age of maturity, they were now officially adopted in the family. And you know what that meant? Now they're part of the inheritance. Does that make sense? And so just because you're born in that family, it doesn't mean you're going to be a part of that inheritance. You have to be mature. And it is kind of the same way today. If a child is a beneficiary and they're a child and their beneficiary dies, they don't just write a check for, you know, $72,000 and hand it to a 6-year-old kid and say, have a good life. They don't do that. They have to be mature enough to have an administrator to administrate the will to them. Well, that's the same concept. You understand what I'm saying? But here's what I'm getting to. Forget all that. Just get a hold of this. When you're born again, you are immediately part of the inheritance of God. Now, is that cool? That's cool. It's not that you're born again and one day you're going to get eternal life and the blessing. No, immediately you get all of God that there is to get, and you're plugged in. You are in the inheritance of God Himself. And that's what the Bible is talking about. He said, we're in the family of God. And when you're in the family of God, the church, you're part of everything that God is. Listen to what the Bible says in Ephesians chapter 1, verse 5 again. God's unchanging plan has always been to adopt us into His own family. Adopt by, I'm plugging you into the total inheritance the minute you're born again. By bringing us to Himself through Jesus Christ. And this gave Him great pleasure. God wants everybody to be a part of His family. And our spiritual family is going to outlast our physical families. We were never meant to go through life alone. And that's not true in physical families. Physical families are often separated by death. They're separated by divorce. They're separated by a departure. Somebody just leaves. And God hates loneliness. As a matter of fact, God's commentary over the beautiful world that He spoke into existence when He looked at man, He said, it is not good that what? Man should be alone. God doesn't want us to go through life alone. As a matter of fact, He wants the opposite for us. When you're born physically, you automatically are part of the human race. You had no choice in that. But you become part of the human family, no choice of your own, but you become part of God's family by choice. You have to make a decision. I want to be a part of God's family. Doesn't just happen. And so the Bible says God has given us the privilege of being born again so that now we are now members of God's very own family. Now, I've talked about it already, but let me just go back to it just a moment. What does it mean to be born again? It means that I choose to ask God to forgive me of my sin and to adopt me into His family. Are you getting it? That adoption is, I'm in total inheritance of everything that God has for me. This is through belief that Jesus is who He said He was and did what He said He would do. Confession that I'm a sinner and that's all that I am. That sin has separated me from Christ. And repentance, I ask God to forgive me of my sin, and I'm turning from my sin to my Savior. That's what repentance is, a change in direction. I'm changed. I'm a new creation. I live in a new relationship with God through Jesus Christ. Listen to what Timothy said. 1 Timothy chapter 3, verse 15. That family is the church of the living God, the support and the foundation of truth. Now, the family that we're talking about of the living God, He said, is the support and the foundation of truth. Now, you and I know the importance of having a good foundation, right? As a matter of fact, people in Texas try to have good foundations and still have foundational problems because your house is only as good as the foundation that it sits upon. I was thinking about when I was preparing this message, all the earthquakes that had happened in Turkey. Remember that just a few weeks ago, a couple months ago maybe. And the devastation of the earthquake. And here's the problem. In our world, people all around us, in your life, in my life, people all around our life are having earthquakes, relational earthquakes, physical earthquakes, financial earthquakes. That is wrecking people's life. Are you tracking with me? But the Bible says the importance of being part of the church is it gives you a foundation and strength when disasters of life come. You know why? Because you're not alone in it. You're not alone. Somebody recently said to me, well, Brother Charlie, I'm not all that keen on large churches. And so I said, you better get king because heaven's going to be a big place. I'm telling you, everybody that moves here, that may not know it, but I know they need a church home. We need to say, God loves you, you matter, but you matter not just to God, you matter to us. Because you're going to have earthquakes in your life, and you're going to need support and foundation of the truth. God's purpose for us is to love God and to love people. We're in the people business. As our congregation grows, we have to make more room for more of God's children. A life without support collapses. And we know the importance, as I said, the foundation. The church gives support, the truth. And I just have in my notes a couple ideas about that. Not just part of the church, but be a part of a Sunday school class. The Sunday school is the shepherding center of the church. We don't just need to be able to say, we invite you to come and celebrate the resurrection with us here on Sunday and sing the wonderful songs and hear the praises of people to God and to hear the preaching of the Word of God. But you need to drill down. You don't only just need a Sunday school, a worship service. You need a small group because that's where ministry really takes place. And so guess what? Because of that, we need more and more Sunday school rooms to help people. Shepherding centers of our church. That's why Romans 12, 5, Paul says we belong to each other. And each of us needs the others. It's God's purpose that we know and love people. The church is not just an organization where there's rules and rituals. It is a place where we build relationships, not just with God, but with one another. I hear people sometimes that say something like this. Well, Brother Charlie, I'm not even sure we need church. I mean, I go out in nature, and I worship God in nature. And I'm going to go, duh. God created nature. How could you not? You can go out and worship God and be blown away in worship just in nature. But here's what you can't do. You can't be out in nature by yourself and love God and people. And God don't want you just worshiping Him and loving Him. God wants His family to love one another and thereby to grow to be more like Christ. That's part of it. You can worship, but you can't love people in nature out there by yourself. We are to learn to love God and to love people and to learn to love real people, not ideal people. And so, I said this before, we all got a Cousin Eddie in our life. We all got a Cousin Eddie, right? And if you hadn't watched the movie, you don't know what I'm talking about. But he's pretty famous, so I think you probably do. And, you know, they're just a few fries short of a Happy Meal. You know what I'm talking about. And, you know, it's coming Easter, and they've already said, we're coming. They're just totally out of the loop on social skills. But God says, I love that. I love Cousin Eddie. And I care about him. And I want you to love Cousin Eddie. And the church is a laboratory to help us learn how to love Cousin Eddie. And we all have them in your home. And as I said one time before, I said, think about who the Cousin Eddie is in your family. And if you can't think of who that is, you're probably Cousin Eddie. And if that's true, aren't you glad God loves you? He loves you and He cares about everything going on in your life. And so by being a part of the church, we learn that some of us wear tags, or should wear tags maybe, extra grace required. They're just heavenly sandpaper that smooth us out and help us learn how to love. But here's the deal. You can only do that when you're being more and more conformed to the image of Christ. And so that's the third thing that I would say that our church should be about. and that is to be conformed to Christ's image. The church exists as a family to help newborn Christians grow to maturity. Because unlike being born in the physical world, you automatically grow. You can be born in the spiritual world and not necessarily grow up. How many of you know that's true? Jesus Christ is the model of our spiritual maturity. That's part of his ministry, to model maturity. We are to have the ministry of the Messiah. And Luke chapter 4, Jesus is telling them, this is what the Messiah is about. Preaching the gospel to the poor so that they may see, encouraging the brokenhearted, announcing hope to the oppressed. Care for those who have lost their way. Equip believers for the work of the ministry to believers and be on mission to the unchurched. Preparing for our future means that we are willing to do more than sacrifice financially. It means that we must be willing ourselves, not just to sacrifice financially, but to sacrifice our time by serving and using our abilities in the various ministries that need to be manned, and to accept the 4x4 challenge, which means I'm going to, in my world, identify unchurched people in my life. I'm going to begin to intercede for those people that they would be willing to enter into a spiritual conversation with me. I'm going to invest in their life so that I'm turning a friendship or an acquaintance into a friendship, a relationship, and then I'm going to begin to invite them to come to Christ, certainly, and come to the church. You see, we can invest and we can sacrifice and we can remodel and we could just make this the model building. All right, we can do that. But if we don't do the other, this is pointless. We're only doing that so that we can do this more effectively. Amen. And so honoring our past and building on our future is more than just an offering and a commitment of giving money. It is saying, I'm giving a full yes of myself to God. I'm going to be an and then some person. I want to be who you want me to be, God, and where you want me to be. I'm willing to do whatever to see that the kingdom of God is expanded and the church of Central Baptist is the church that God wants it to be. Now, am I making sense? Amen. Listen to Romans chapter 8, verse 29. This is out of the Living Bible. From the very beginning, God decided that those who come to him, that is, choose to become believers, choose to be born again, ask Christ to come into their heart. And all along he knew who would become like his son. We look at the son and see God's original purpose for everything that he created. And so he says the whole purpose is that we become like God. We don't become gods. I mean, there's cults out there that says you can become God. Well, that's ignorance. But he wants us to become godly. More like Christ. Acting more like him, modeling Christ, godly character of integrity and generosity and humility. God is far more interested in who we are than what we are. You're not taking your career to heaven with you. Some people go, well, praise the Lord. But you are taking your character to heaven with you. Everything in life is used by God to help us grow to spiritual maturity. The good things, the bad things, the ugly things in life. God never does evil, but he brings good out of evil things that happen in our life. And so part of the reason that we endure some things, part of the reason we go through some things that we go through is that God is using that very thing that we didn't want to go through to mature us to be more like him. For instance, God turns crucifixion into resurrection. The most horrible thing that ever happened from a human standpoint would be the Messiah, God himself, dying and being crucified for us. But out of that, he brought the resurrection that brings eternal life to everyone. Made all the difference in the world. There's nothing in your life that you can't learn from if you'll just respond with the right attitude instead of saying, why in the world, God, is this happening? What, God, are you wanting to do in my life? Now, I was thinking about this. If God's purpose is for us to be conformed to the image of Christ, what does that look like? What does that look like? And here's what I conclude in my thinking. It concludes so that in our life, in our physical life, we are producing the fruit of the Spirit of God. The fruit of the Spirit of God. If you want to describe Christ, I don't think you could describe him any better than to give the fruits of the Spirit. And here they are, the fruits of the Spirit. Listen to this. That God is at work in our life and making an impact in our life. Love, joy, peace, patience, goodness, gentleness, faithfulness, meekness, and self-control. These are all qualities that God wants to produce in our life. Every problem has a purpose. And he wants to produce something out of it. So, how does God produce love? We come to the altar, and I have this little one, and I just put sparkles on you, and you go, I just love everybody. No. You know how God teaches you to love? He puts you around Cousin Eddie. I'm not joking. Anybody can love the cool people. But it takes the Holy Spirit of God to get you to love the unlovely. Are you hearing me? How does God produce joy in your life? He gives you a raise at work. Happiness is circumstantial. It's not what joy is. Many times, God takes you through grief in order to help you appreciate who he is and what he's done, and that brings joy into your heart. Am I making sense? How does he produce patience? I have four cars. You have to go to the tag place and get a tag. Department of Motor Vehicles. That's how you have to learn patience, right? It's in ways that we don't think. But God says, here's what I'm doing. I'm molding you. I'm making you. Everything that's happening in your life, I'm using it to make you more like Christ so that in your life, you're manifesting the fruits of the Spirit of God. All these qualities enable us to serve God more effectively. Ephesians chapter 2, verse 10. Now, the Good News Bible, it says this. God made us what we are in Jesus Christ. God made us to do good works, which he planned in advance for us to live our lives doing. Can I give you another name for good works? Ministry. We all have a ministry to other believers. Listen to what Peter said. God has given each of you some special abilities. Be sure and use them to help each other, passing on to others God's many kinds of blessings. You serve God on this planet by serving people. And we have plans for that. You say, well, who told you to make plans? Well, because God makes plans, we make plans. Say, God makes plans? Yes, Jeremiah 29, 11. These are the plans I've made for you, says the Lord. God has a plan for your life. God's plan for our life. The Bible says where there's no vision, people perish. God's vision must be our vision. Solomon said, those who embrace my ways are most blessed. This life is not about us. We are God's stewards of all that he has entrusted to us. I love what the Bible says in Acts chapter 10, verse 35. This is again out of the Message paraphrase edition. It says like this. It makes no difference who you are or where you're from. If you want God and you're ready to do as he says, The door is open. Aren't you glad that God has an open door for you? Aren't you glad that God has an open door for our church? Listen, he said, if you're ready to do what I want you to do, come on in. And make all the impact that you want to in the world in which you're in. God did not put us here to be a consumer. He put us here to be a contributor. To contribute our abilities, our talents, our resources. He gave you your talents not for you, but for us. So that you can be a blessing to other people. So that we can make a contribution to the kingdom of God. Nothing in your past has ruined your ability to be serving God in the future. Doesn't matter. In eternity, we will use all of our eternity in serving God. You want to know what you're going to do in eternity? You're going to be serving God, and you're going to do it perfectly. Can you imagine? Can you imagine? I love the song, Sweet Hour of Prayer. One of the phrases in the old song, Sweet Hour of Prayer, this robe I'll rise and seize the prize. And one of these days, you know, I want to serve God. I want to serve God perfectly now. How many of you think I serve God perfectly now? No. I disappoint myself, let alone God, all the time in my life. But I know one day this robe of flesh is going to drop away, and I am in my glorified life for the trillions and trillions of years throughout eternity going to serve him perfectly. Amen. How cool is that? But I need to be practicing it now. Practicing it now. And I need to be practicing it in the way that God said. I used to play golf. I haven't played golf in a long, long, long time. And I went to an instructor in playing golf. And he said, he watched me swing. He said, you have two problems. One, you stand on the wrong side of the ball when you approach it, because I hit it left-handed. And B, you stand too close to the ball after you hit it. So, I said, man, I've been practicing. He said, now listen to me, Charles. Practice doesn't make perfect. It makes permanent. God just doesn't want us practicing. He wants us practicing to perfection. I say it again. This is an embassy of heaven. When people come on this campus, they should sense something of heaven here. Amen? We are ambassadors. We ought to be representing the kingdom of God in our world as an ambassador of the Lord Jesus Christ. Yes or no? And so as a church, when God says, when the world says, I'm moving to where you are, the church ought to be having a holy hootenanny saying, come on down. God loves you and so do we. Does that make sense? Now, I want to tell you, it's time for us to get ready. But you can't get ready for that if you're not ready for God yourself. And many people have lived their whole life and never get around to the purpose of life, and that is to know and love God. Do you know and love God? Have you given your heart to Christ, and have you followed him in obedience? Have you been baptized? Are you a member of a church? Are you helping contribute, or are you still receiving and never contributing back? It's not about you. I want you to stand with me. Father, we right now bow in your presence. We thank you, Lord, for the day you've given us and the blessing of it. We know, Lord, that this day is the day that you have made. And it's not an accident that we're in this room. And that, Lord, you are calling us out. You're preparing us to be ready for our eternity. We're going to spend more trillions of years on the other side of our afterlife. This life is a preparation for eternity. Our church is to help people get ready for eternity. That's why we're here. That's why you planted 105 years ago a church here in this community. Because you knew that this day was coming. They didn't know it then. I didn't know it when I came here. But you knew it. And Lord, you've been on the backs and shoulders of others who said, we're just going to live for Christ. And Lord, they brought it this far, and now you said, now it's your turn to live for Christ. God, help us to be willing to say yes, a full yes to God in Jesus' name. Will you come?
Just as I am without one plea, but that thy blood was shed for me.
Thank you, Mike. Listen, I want to just thank you for being here today. Remember, if you're a guest, Mike and Kim will be out those doors. We have a gift for you. We'd love for you to receive that. Brother Birdwell came down. I'm going to tell you a story just briefly, brother. He's a teacher, and we've been praying for him. Many of our people has cancer, and he went to the doctor, and the doctor said it stopped in its tracks. And now we need to hear that. But he didn't do it so he would feel better and so he could live longer. He did it because he has a plan and purpose for his life. And he wants to live out God's purpose. He wants to live what days he has. He wants to live out the purpose. That should be every one of us. We don't know. Every one of us in here is terminal. Do you know that, right? Every one of us in here. And we don't know when that is, but we know it is coming. Only a fool knows there's something coming and not prepare for it. Do you know him? Do you know the Lord? Do you know that you know that you know? You should. Amen. The day's coming. Amen. We celebrate with you, Brother Birdwell. We rejoice in God's healing of your body. Let me close with the passage of scripture that I love to close with. It's in the Old Testament, in the book of Numbers. It's the word that was given to... Moses gave it to Aaron to say this to the people of God. The Lord said, the Lord bless you and keep you and make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. My prayer is that you will go in peace. My prayer is that you'll be in prayer. As we talked about last week, prayer is the warfare. Now, I'm closing with just this word. Some people ask me, Brother Charlie, in our daily prayer time, I'm struggling with it. I just took my daily prayer time and adjusted it some. I didn't put anything personal about people I'm praying for. So nobody's name's in it. But I have some copies. If you're interested in that, I'll get you copies. I have some here. And I have plenty more. If you want just it's just a model, a template. I'm nothing. I'm no one. People ask. I did. I offer to you. God bless you.
Thank you for joining us online today. We are so glad that you were a part of the service. If you have any questions about what it means to have a relationship with Jesus Christ, about baptism, or how to join our family at Central Baptist Church, we would love to answer your questions. You can use Facebook Messenger to send us a message, or you can call or email the church. You will find our phone and email information on our website. Thank you again for worshiping with us today, and may God bless you and give you peace.